Well, I want to thank everyone for coming this afternoon. We have a whole bunch of bills that I've either signed or returned unsigned. No bills vetoed. And I wanted to go through them with you because they're all very extremely important for the most part. Before I go into each of the bills, I do want to really thank the council for their very hard work on all the budget bills that were put before them. For the most part, the initiatives that were pushed by the administration were actually funded and supported in the council. And it took a lot of hard work, a lot of hearings and gathering information. And I particularly want to thank Ann Kobayashi, the budget chair, and the budget committee for their extremely hard work. Without what they did, we'd not be standing here today talking about what I believe is a very strong, fiscally prudent budget where we're spending to make a difference. And I do emphasize that. It's spending to make a difference. We've tried to control our budget growth, and for the most part, we have. And where we've funded, it's because we believe it's going to make a difference in our community in very, very important ways. Having said that, I want to first talk about our legislative and executive budget bills. As you know, the council has their legislative budget, and we have our executive branch budget, both operating and capital improvement. And I wanted to let you know that all three of those bills are being returned unsigned. And this is not something new. I've done this in the 2 other years that I've been mayor. For the most part, because in these budgets, there are references to the hard budget. And we have a long and ongoing disagreement with the council and the authority of the council to deal with the hard budget. Not just me as mayor, but the previous mayor, Peter Carlisle, had the same issues. As you know, the people of the city and county of Honolulu voted on a charter amendment creating HART. They wanted to take politics and politicians out of the budget-making process for HART. I've abided by that process and have not influenced or tried to in any way affect the budget of HART. The council disagrees. They want to be involved in that budget. And I think that's not what the people of the island of Oahu voted for in the charter amendment. They did not want a mayor, because we remember before HART was created, it was under the Department of Transportation Services, Rapid Transit Division, reporting directly to the mayor. Well, indirectly, first to the director of Department of Transportation Services, then the mayor. That was done to take the mayor and all politicians out of the process. And I'm going to honor that. The council disagrees, and they have continued to play with the budget. And so in our executive operating and capital improvement budget, they have references to the HART budget. And so I'm not signing it for that reason. There's also an issue that's been ongoing between me and certain members of the council, and that's on grants and aid, GIA money. As you know, the people of this island voted on a charter amendment back in 2012 to set aside 0.5% of the operating budget, 0.5% of the operating budget, which is about $6 million, to go towards grants and aid. And they said they wanted a committee set up, a selection committee, to decide who should get this money. So there's no pork barrel, kind of like Congress had pork barrel and Congress did away with it, where every politician picks their favorite 501c3 and says, I want to fund that. Take politics out of the process. Let this committee select those who are going to get the grants and aid money at 0.5%. What has happened this year, as in previous years, is that they've expended more than 0.5%, a lot more. And they have funded programs below the cutoff point. And this year, for the very first time, is they didn't just take the grants and aid money, they took general fund money and added it to the grants and aid money. So they created a hybrid that makes it much more complicated to fund, and I'm not going to be releasing general fund money to fund this hybrid grants and aid. So that's the second reason why I'm returning these budgets, these bills unsigned. And here's an interesting point. The state of Hawaii has a grants and aid operating budget for this fiscal year, that is about $8 million. Want to hazard a guess what ours is? $7.9 million. The state's operating budget is $6 billion. The city's operating budget is $2 billion. We're almost equal in terms of our grant and aid operating expenditures. Way out of whack, way out of balance, in a city that has huge demands on core infrastructure. Cities unlike the state are about sewer and water and parks and homelessness and road repaving and bus restoration and building rail. It's not about giving millions of dollars away to very worthy causes, but causes that I think are more at a state level than a city level. And this is not Robin Hood stealing from the rich and giving to the poor. This is our taxpayer money, gathered through real property taxes and other sources to be expended on things that the people of this island expect to be expended on, making sure that their infrastructure is well taken care of. And this administration is all about infrastructure, infrastructure, and more infrastructure. I'm troubled by this. It needs to be brought back into balance. It needs to be the 0.5% that I voted for and the people of this island voted for, not half a percent plus. And definitely nowhere near what the state is spending. Our budgets are nowhere close to each other. So very, very troubled by that. That's the second reason. The third reason is one that you've all covered, and that's the Office of Strategic Development. As you know, we fought long and hard to try to keep that money in. It's about $616,000 to create seven positions. We have three right now. We wanted to add more to really focus on our homeless challenge. And as you know, everyone, every day, the Star Advertiser and every one of the TV stations talks about homelessness, and more needs to be done. And as mayor, I have not run away from the issue. I haven't said, like other people have said, it's a state issue, and the state's saying it's a city issue, and no one does anything. We stepped up, we embraced it, and we are moving the needle and making a difference. But much, much more needs to be done. The council agrees. They gave us $32 million last year in bond money to address the homeless issue, to find housing. $32 million. This year, they put another $32 million. Now we have $64 million to expend. We're not in the housing business. The people of this island took us out of the housing business under the Eva Villages scandal 20 years ago. But we're back in it again, and we're gearing up. And I don't want to create a bureaucracy. Some council members have proposed that maybe we need to create a Department of Housing. I don't want to do that. I don't want to grow another bureaucracy or create another department. But I do want to get the staff that we need to make the kind of decisions that this city has not made since we got out of the housing business. We need people that know how to purchase buildings and land to close the escrow. They need to know how to do valuations, how to decide what's a good deal and what isn't, to negotiate a closing, to handle the closing, and then handle the construction, the renovation, and all of those kinds of things that we don't do. We have three folks that are really good at it, and we've started to make a difference. The first one came on in November of last year. So 7 months ago now, and you've seen in the past couple months our initiatives that we've been announcing, we've been lumbering down the runway and we're taking off. And just as we take off, the council grabbed the money and put it to other places. And here's the ironic thing. Well, they may argue, or their chair may argue, that we're creating a bureaucracy. What did they do? They took money and they added three positions to the council. Two for homelessness, a housing coordinator and an assistant housing coordinator. But they're telling us we find the money somewhere else and they add it. And they created a heart oversight position at the council, three people. And here's the interesting fact that I didn't know, but I started questioning, you know, this issue about bureaucracy and building. When the current chair started as a chair back in 2011, there were six positions that reported to him, six. Today, there's 12, double what it was. He added three people in a previous budget, and he added three more that I just described under this budget. So there is bureaucracy building going on here. I want to spend where it's effective. I believe that if we do not have the staff to help us expend the $64 million and place more people into houses, into homes with wraparound services under Housing First Initiative, it becomes a much more difficult task and challenge. But this administration is not one to say no. We're not folks to say we're not going to give up on trying. We're going to dig in and try to find the money somewhere else. So we've committed to the three people that have been hired. You're not going to be let go. We will find the money to continue making sure you're doing the great things you started to do. And if we can find more money, we'll add more staff. We're going to have to dig for it and find it. But it's unfortunate, it really is unfortunate we have to be in this position on something that the people of this island have demanded we do more on. We should be working together, and I want to work together. The final thing regarding those three bills I just described is they've created this new deputy clerk position in the clerk's office. As you may know, under the revised charter of the City and County of Honolulu, it says the city clerk shall appoint necessary staff. The city clerk shall appoint all necessary staff. The council has a duty to choose the city clerk. In 1958, the Charter Commission said the authority extended, the city clerk's authority, the council's authority only extended to the city clerk, not any other staffing, just to the city clerk. In 1971 and 72, the Charter Commission, as you know, we have a new Charter Commission, we're going to be looking at amendments in 2016, decided not to amend the charter to address personal matters affecting the city clerk's office because the city clerk already had that authority to hire more people. So in 2015, the council wanted to select a new city clerk, and they created this special city clerk search committee. I like that. A process was set up, a search committee was created to look for the best person to replace the outgoing city clerk. And they got applications for the job, and they went through them and they picked someone. Then what did they do? They went and created a new deputy city clerk position that was not announced, was not advertised, was not made known to anyone, was not part of this selection process. And one person was picked, and there were many qualified people in the city clerk's office, some serving 20, 30 years, who probably would have applied for the job if they'd known it was available. It wasn't made known, and they picked someone. And for that reason, I'm returning the legislative budget bill back, unsigned by me. Troubling. And I think there should be a more open, transparent process to pick and create new positions in the city clerk's office. As you know, the city clerk's job, one of them is controlling, mandate, watching elections, making sure they're done properly, and there should be openness and transparency, and everyone should get a chance to apply for the job. The next set of bills regards the HART budget bills. Those are bills 17, 18, and 19. And as I mentioned, just like in the executive budget operating and CIP, I return them unsigned. I'm returning 17, 18, and 19 unsigned also for the same reason. There's a batch of bills that I call the third set, which I call miscellaneous. I signed them all, except for one. Bill 66, 67, 68, 69, 71, 72, 73, and 15. 15 deals with city bonds, but not HART bonds, just city bonds for sewer and those kind of things. I didn't sign Bill 40. Bill 40 pertains to creating another special fund, the Waipio Peninsula Soccer Park Special Fund. You know, I really found it interesting. The Star Advertiser a while ago wrote a lead editorial, maybe a month or two ago, you know, saying they really liked what Sylvia Lucas, the finance chair, and Joe Takuda as the Ways and Means chair were doing by cutting back on special funds. You know, when I was at the legislature, legislators love to create special funds to placate special interest groups. And people say fiscally, monetarily, it's irresponsible to do that. And both Sylvie Luke and Joe Takuda have been looking to cut back and do away with those special funds. We, on the other hand, are going in the other direction. We created a Corp special fund, and now we created a YPO Park special fund. Now, what does that do? It doesn't create more money. The money is the money. It all goes into one pot, wherever it's collected from. So the fact that there is money dedicated to any one park doesn't mean there's more money. And in fact, the difference still has to be funded by the people of the city and county of Honolulu. So here's the interesting thing. On the Waipio Peninsula Soccer Park, in fiscal year 14, the money collected that would go into a special fund if it existed back then was $86,614. $86,614 was collected. In FY14, the expenses for that park were $635,872, meaning that special fund gets nowhere near what it needs to operate that park, and the rest comes from the general fund. Now, the money, this $86,000, went into the general fund, and it was all, you know, given back to that park and other parks. So there is no difference. It's not like they're getting more money, or money was taken away from them that they otherwise wouldn't get. The money is expended based on the needs of every park around this island. So we are for that park, and we need to do better in all our parks. As you know, one of the five initiatives of this administration is doing better maintenance and care for our parks. And we have CACO for our parks that we initiated. We put more money into our parks budget for different parks around this island and districts. And we're going around and fixing up bathrooms and taking care of the parks better and trying to make sure they're green. And YPO is an example of that initiative. Yes, but we need to do more. But if we create special funds for these two parks, I mean, I can think of special funds for all kinds of parks. Kapi'olani, Ala Moana, you know, think about all the parks on the North Shore, Haleiwa. I mean, the fact that you create the fund and you tell the constituents of that area, look, I'm giving you more money, is misleading to the public and misleading to the users of that park, because it means nothing about more money. Nothing about more money. It's the same amount of money, but it creates bureaucracy because Nelson Koyanagi, the budget director, now has to account for that money in a special fund and report it differently. And so more bureaucratic money expenditures are made doing this. But no additional money comes to that park. But we're committed, and Michelle is right here, committed, right, Michelle, to do more, and we are doing more. And we need to do more than what we're doing now. And you got my commitment on that. So that's it for the bills, a whole bunch. I ran through a bunch of them. I opened to questions from you on those bills. And then if there's other things you want to ask me about, I'll stick around. And of course, Nelson and Gary's over there, and Michelle, stick around for other questions on the side. But again, I want to emphasize, I'm very grateful for the council. You've heard me say things that are troubling, but I'm grateful for the council for the hard work they did do, and particularly the budget committee. And like I said, all five of our initiatives plus homelessness are funded, but like in any process, there is going to be disagreement. And I've talked about that disagreement, but I also want to know that the whole thing wrapped together, good job, and I'm grateful.
So Mayor, a little clarification. When you're creating the Office of Strategic Development and the City Council Chair creating a deputy clerk, I mean, are those things illegal, or I mean, isn't that your prerogative?
I'm not saying they're illegal, it's their prerogative, but I think that, I think that they've exceeded their authority by adding to their legislative bureaucracy. I mean, you look at the state legislature, not creating positions like that. In fact, I mean, I used to serve there, but you got the auditor reporting to the legislature and is appointed by the legislature. But I see a mini bureaucracy being built, and I think they're intruding into the executive branch where they should focus on policy. As you know, the legislative branch is all about policy, and the executive branch is about implementing that policy. And I am troubled, and I think they are intruding on the executive branch. And that's part of the reason why I returned it unsigned.
So segueing into the parks, with the $635,000 that they need, can't you withhold the $86,000 and just give them the money because you are in the execution mode?
Why don't we have the budget director address that?
Yeah. You want to answer that?
Actually, what happens is that $86,000 goes into the general fund, and the general fund fully supports the park. So indirectly, they get all the money back anyway. So by setting up the fund, like Mayor says, it doesn't create any more revenue.
So it's not a plus up of $86,000.
No.
You said you're going to restrict general funds. You're not going to allow general funds to be used for some of those grants and aids. Can you give me a sense of how much money that is you're withholding?
I don't know if we know the exact number of the money that's being
withheld. He's not referring to the charter mandated grants and aid that came through the grant and aid process. He's just referring to the earmarks they added on top
of
that.
Right, yeah.
So the earmarks, you know, I'm just like I've announced in previous years, you know, going outside of what the people of this island voted for under the charter amendment, I said I would not release that money, and I have not.
Okay, so you're not going to release that money?
So the general fund money, I don't want to release that money because I think it's a hybrid. It's not what the people voted for. We're right back to pork barrel. Right back to pork barrel again. Just take general fund money and give it to your favorite charity. And I think that is not what the people one, plus I support the idea of doing away with pork barrel. Align a committee that's more objective and a little further away from the decision-making that politicians are under to fund. And so I think we're going in the opposite direction, and it's something I think is not good policy.
So can you refuse to also fund the positions that the council wants to fund?
You want to answer that, Nelson?
No, I don't believe he can. The council has their own legislative budget, and the mayor doesn't have control over that budget in the sense that he does over the operating or capital budget of the executive branch.
But theoretically, the mayor can't even veto the legislative budget, right?
You know, if our corporation council was up here, I think, you know, I could line item those provisions, but I've elected not to. Because I, you know, for me, I want to work with the council. And I think for the most part, I have an excellent working relationship with most of the council members. And like I said, a lot of things that we pushed in our budget are there and strongly supported. So, you know, I'm returning unsigned and making a clear statement for the public, but I don't think it rises to the level that I would look at line item vetoing those items.
Please, Douglas, add that for a second. You know, those two homeless positions are supposed to be homeless policy positions. As you pointed out, it's their job to do policy. It's your job to implement policy. So isn't that just doing what they're supposed to be doing?
Well, I mean, and you're raising an issue that I think is a valid one to discuss, but here's my point is how many policy people do they need to add? You know, they could have policy positions on every issue, on parks, on road repaving, on transportation in general. And I think it goes beyond what legislatures usually do. And I think they're playing some, you know, using names to get around the issue of violating, you know, by calling them policy. I think it's something that's not necessary. And it's ironic that while they denied us our funding, they created funding for their own side on homelessness.
Can you just elaborate a little bit about your comment that you think the chairman was creating an enlarging bureaucracy? What do you think he's trying to do?
No, you got to ask him that. There's no more elaboration than what I said on, you know, I've stated the facts, but if you want to ask him, you got to ask him, not me.
You know, the public mayor is wondering, why aren't you talking with the chair? Why are you trying to do all your policies to the news media? Why don't you just go talk to him about these things?
I don't know, Wayne, if what the public is asking. I mean, I hear from the public every day, and I've not been asked that, but as a matter of fact, when I became mayor, we had a standing lunch meeting every other week, and you know, after a couple months, he stopped coming. And I asked a few times, and when he didn't come, I took it off my calendar. You got to ask him.
On the issue of the HART funding, I mean, because we're at the front end of rail, I mean, wouldn't it be best to kind of clear up this issue as to who's overstepping whose boundaries on this?
Catherine, it's a good question. I don't know if it can be cleared up outside of a court action, you know, getting some kind of declaration from the court. Clearly, the council and the executive branch disagree on this issue. And the only way it can be cleared up, you have to go to a third party. That would be the judicial branch, right? You've got the legislative, executive branch. We disagree. An action would need to be brought to the to court. Now, I'm preserving that right by returning these bills unsigned so someone can't later say you signed them. Now, how come you're raising the disagreement? I don't think it rises to the level of a court challenge at this point. I want to preserve the executive branch's options on behalf of all the people of the city and county of Honolulu. And I'm sending a clear message to the council that they really should stop doing this. Some point in the future, we may take that action, but I don't think it's risen to that level at this point.
So as things stand, because it is going to become law, and all this will happen anyway.
Right. That's correct. Unless I veto the bill, and if I veto, they can override and can still become law. Return it unsigned means it becomes law. But I'm stating clearly what my position is. I believe it's part of the openness and transparency this administration has embraced.
Back to the GIA question. Can we ask Nelson to respond to the question that was asked earlier about how much money are we really talking about that's in the operating that they put in for GIA?
Yeah, I believe, I don't have the figures offhand, but I believe it was about $1.9 million of general funds in addition to about $6 million from the GIA through the half a percent of general fund revenues.
That's
So in terms of trying to find $616,000 for those positions, isn't it true that you found extra money to do the King Street bike lanes in the tune of $500,000 from carryover money?
No, that came out of that was done by the staff of the Department of Transportation Services and Department of...
That wasn't carryover money?
No.
How much carryover money do you have?
I don't have that figure offhand.
30 million? It's usually about 33 million.
Whatever amounts that are carried over are actually used to balance the budget. So regardless of the amount that was carried over, it's part of the budget amount.
And it could fund the positions?
No, because it's part of the budget. Whatever the budget is, and this year is about $2.2 billion, that includes the carryover from the prior year.
So in the existing fiscal year, the money was used from the settlement, right, from the ORI settlement?
That was part of it. I'm talking about funding the positions. In this year, part of the funding was used from the settlement with HUD administrative order. And the other, the major portion was from salary savings in certain departments that were used to fund the positions.
And that's where the money is going to come from?
Well, this year, I think next year we need to search for the money, but I think it probably will come from vacant positions. And it'll be positions that are, necessary, but because this is such a priority, we'll probably fill these positions instead.
Back to the Office of Strategic Development, 616, right, to fund the 7.
16,488, I believe.
416,488. Okay. So roughly, you said you probably are going to be able to retain the 3 that you put on this year. Roughly, how many do you think total will you be able to have in the coming year, and how is that going to affect the way you are able to help the homeless and to create housing in the coming year?
Yeah, I'll answer the first part of the question as far as how much, how many positions we can fund. It really depends. Like I said, the funding is not there. We need to look for it. Either, getting a vacant position that would have been filled by another, person and using that money to fund these positions. So it really depends. And as far as how they're going to do the work, I'll leave that up to them.
Now, so as Gordon said, as Nelson said, Gordon, it's going to depend on where we find that money, vacant funded positions, other things. Of course, I would like to get up to 7. I think if we get the full complement of staff that we intended, we can do more quicker. And the public's demanding that we do more quicker. The good news is we can find the money for the 3, and if Nelson can find savings in other ways, we'll have a 4th, a 5th, a 6th, a 7th. But again, the reason why we put it in our budget is we want to be open and transparent. We want to tell people, the public, the taxpayers, we're spending this money in this way for these staff. The council sometimes say, why didn't you tell us what you were doing? Why did you hire these people outside of our regular budget process? So we're following the process, and they're saying, go behind the scenes and find the money in other ways. That then they sometimes get irritated at. But obviously with the decision that is made, we're not walking away from trying to tackle the homeless problem. We're full steam ahead. We're going to continue to push new initiatives, and we need a staff to do it. We have 3, and if we can find the money, we'll add a 4th, 5th, 6th, and 7th. And I'm hoping in coming years, if we can demonstrate that we're doing more to house homeless, that they will step up, the council will, and actually fund in an open and transparent way the staff that we need, that the public needs, in order to get more folks off of our streets and sidewalks and parks into housing, where they can be taken care of and gotten back on their feet, and then we can bring more people into it.
Where exactly did you find the money for the 3?
We had a settlement, or I remember that it was a settlement that was done maybe a year and a half ago now. We had some extra money left over. We couldn't spend it without the approval of HUD. We went and got an order from HUD to spend that money. There was some irritation that we did it that way instead of asking the council for the money for the staff. But we did it because we wanted to start hiring people. We couldn't wait for the next budget cycle. But now they're saying do exactly what we did, that they're irritated about, by going finding the money the other way.
Well, they said there's a lot of fat in the budget.
Well, they were irritated that we didn't come forward in the last year and say we needed additional staff. Now they're saying just find it out of that fat, supposed fat in our budget.
Okay.
The proper way is for the council to fund positions for the administration.
Yeah.
Last year, he wanted to get it running in the middle of the fiscal year because we have a crisis, but then went to the council to get them to fund it, but instead they said, no, just do it.
Because you did it, you didn't come to us the first time and tell us how you're going to do it, so now we're taking the money away and telling you to go do it the way you did it last year, finding it under other sources. You know, in that case, it was through the settlement. We'll look for other ways also. Like I said, the takeaway point is, we're not backing away, we're not giving up, we're going to continue to fund the staff we need to help encumber the $64 million we now have and do more to get more people off of our streets, sidewalks, roads, and parks.
Would it be accurate to say that you're frustrated by the actions of the council with respect to your homeless initiatives?
You know, Gordon, I think making good policy decisions is paramount in my mind, and I think this administration has always stood on the right side of policy. I get irritated sometimes when politics kicks in through the policy side of things. I am a politician, and I live in that world, but I'd much rather focus on the policy side. And so if there's any frustration, it's when politics plays with policy. We're going to focus on policy. We're going to continue pushing the policy and come in with new programs to house more homeless. New ways, but you know, our housing first, we're not backing away, we've embraced it fully. And the only thing we're going to be doing is stepping up and asking the state to help us. And we've had a meeting or two with the new administration, and they seem willing to provide services that we don't do, the health side, right? We can find buildings and houses and units, but we don't have the wraparound services, but they have a Department of Health and Department of Human Services that can provide that side of the equation, and we're talking to them about doing exactly that.
How are politics getting in the way?
You're asking me to speculate. I just think there is politics. I think the policy decision would have been to fund the positions. That was the right policy thing to do. They're saying they're not against it. They're just saying go find it somewhere else. And I think on policy, they should have done it in an open, transparent way, had the hearings, questioned why we need them, given them to us, by the way, and held our feet to the fire. And if we didn't demonstrate a difference, meet the metrics that we've set, then to cut them in the coming budget cycle.
Mayor, 13 mayors before you have said we could do a lot more if we didn't have a city council. A lot of city council people have said we could do a lot more if we didn't have a mayor. Isn't that the normal process?
Absolutely. I would never say that. As a mayor, as a 14th mayor, I say I believe in the legislative process. I was a legislator. I love our constitution, and I think it's unique. It's inspired. Our founders of our country who created the three branches that I participate in is the best way to govern people. I fully support it, and I like the give and take between the various branches based on policy. But politics does kick in too. But to answer your question, Wayne, absolutely. We need the three branches. It's the way we protect our freedoms. It's more open and transparent than other forms of government, and I like the debate on policy, not as much on politics.
Are these, though, the opening rounds, the opening scuffles in the next year's mayor's race?
I don't think so. You know, for me, I'm focused on doing the hard work that people demand of this city each and every day. Each and every day, Daryl. And, you know, that's what I'm focused on. And you'll have to ask other people. I don't like people, politicians fighting each other. You know, what's happening in Washington. My style is not that way. I think you've seen that in me. I'm not someone who wants to get up and fight. I want to get together and collaborate. I think it's the fact that I was born in White Pollard, grew up in Hilo, small communities where we watch people come in and fight. They're not very effective. I believe a more effective way is to work together. I continue to seek ways to work together.
As you get closer, though, to the mayor's race, are you concerned that it'll be more and more difficult to work with the council?
I don't see it changing any more than the way it is right now, and we'll have to see. I'm not going to speculate. You know, it's a first for me. I've not been mayor more than 2.5 years now, and you know, going through this cycle, we'll see what it's like.
But this budget battle really will define 2016.
I'm not sure on that, Wayne, because we had the same issue. The GIA issue was an issue last year. The HART issue was an issue last year. Strategic housing wasn't an issue because we didn't even have it yet. So a lot of the same issues are still there. So I don't know. You have to ask others, the political pundits, maybe Dan Boylan or something, but not me.
Well, do you believe Bernie Martin's trying to feather his nest? Should he challenge you?
I don't know. You got to ask Ernie. I do think that the bureaucracy is growing at the council level, and that's something I think that the facts are the facts. They speak for themselves. But as far as what he's doing, you got to ask him. I don't want to speculate.
How does having a bureaucracy help someone run for higher office?
You have to ask, I don't know why they're growing their bureaucracy. I think it's the nature of things. I think all, whether it be the legislative side or the executive side, there's a, this bureaucratic thing is like a self-breathing organism, you know, that we all deal with. We're trying to keep our hiring overall flat. I mean, our budget, we can employ up to, 10,000 people about? Mm-hmm. We're at 8,500? And I've asked Nelson and our administration to try to keep it flat, not to grow it. Grow it in the areas that we need spending to make a difference, but not just growing the bureaucracy to grow the bureaucracy. So at the end of the day, controlling bureaucracy controls our unfunded liability. That is huge. And whatever we do to make a difference, if we can keep it flat or even shrink it, you're not going to see a difference for 20 or 30 years because you're talking about funding retirements way out. But I think we need to start that journey now. I've committed to do that, and we're trying to. You know, to your question on how it helps you run for hire, I don't know. I'm not doing it. So you got to ask whoever is doing that if it helps them.
It's generally helpful to have full-time staff that can also serve on your campaign when the time comes.
I don't know. You got to ask him on that. I staffed up in terms of my cabinet with people who I think are qualified for the positions that we put them in.
So, Mayor, back to policymaking.
Yes.
Following through the policy. $32 million current year, $32 million next year.
Yes.
Given that you have a shrunken staff now, that you were hoping to have 7 people in, how much of that $64 million are you hoping to be able to use and to effectuate?
So Gordon, I can't tell you exactly how much. I can tell you this, we're not backing away from the effort. We're gonna be looking to encumber the money. How much depends on a couple things. One, finding the units to purchase or build, and the three people, and maybe four, depending on how many more we can hire, their just ability to work, 5 days a week to expend and encumber that money. So I can't say, but we're going to be reporting as we go forward, what we've encumbered and what we haven't. I'd like to encumber all 64. I'm not promising that we will, but I am promising to your question that we'll work as hard as we possibly can with the limited staff that we have to encumber the money wisely, not just to spend it, but to buy units that are going to work under the Housing First model and not have a negative impact on the surrounding community or on the people who are there. As you know, they've talked about the Hilo Hattie project. One council member said 800 people in one place, that is a ghetto. I don't support spending money to buy a project like that and put 800 homeless people there. And you ask any provider, they say that is beyond a disaster. Maybe 100 or 200. So, you got to look at what you're spending and what you're getting. And we're going to be watching that closely, just like on Sand Island. How many people can we place there that are effective?
Since you raised that point, so is the Hilo Hattie site off the table as far as the admin's concerned?
No, I don't think so. We're still interested, and we're looking. We asked for the information. I'm just saying I wouldn't support 800 folks there. The thing with the Hilo Hattie that needs to be worked out is, the rent is like 106,000 a year. A month. Like 102,000 every month. That is a lot of money. Now Weinberg owns the underlying land, and they do a lot of public service kind of things. I actually called the chair of the Weinberg Foundation to see if we couldn't talk about maybe giving us the land at $1 a year. Then we could purchase the building. That makes more sense, taxpayer side, and from the just funding a program like that. He informed me through my executive assistant that he couldn't talk about it because it's in bankruptcy. And so I've asked Corporation Counsel to take it up from there because I don't want to mess up on the bankruptcy side of things. But it's not off the table, as I've just told you. I personally picked up the phone and called the CEO of the Weinberg Foundation.
And on Sand Island, can you clarify for me, so how is this project different than the homeless villages that Mayor Fossey tried many years ago?
I don't know. I wasn't paying that close attention to what Fossey did or the Weinberg villages, so I couldn't compare the two of them. I think ours is, I like to think of it as a temporary housing first model. You're getting people in, you give them the wraparound services, you do triage, because not everyone in that village is going to be a housing first candidate. They could be people for other kinds of programs, and we'll work hard to put them in those programs. So, but I'm sorry, Catherine, I don't know enough to compare them side by side.
So with the Office of Strategic Development, there's a lot of expertise in the real estate industry that could help you along in terms of closings, in terms of making offers and whatever. So it's not like you're going to be sitting on your hands, right?
Well, obviously we'd reach out where necessary, but just like anyone who's buying a home, you get a real estate agent that gets a commission. That's basically someone working for you. So we're looking for those kinds of people. We need someone on our staff that's actually finding units and protecting the city's interest and then deciding whether that is a good deal or not and getting it done and then getting people moved into it. So this is a lot of effort. Anyone who's bought a condo or a home knows how much time and effort it takes. Now we're talking about doing that for, we've promised the house 400 people. That's a lot of work and a lot of effort.
Mayor, it's past 2:30, so we got to wrap soon.
Some of the homeless advocates have suggested that maybe there are some monies that the council set aside that could be used for shallow subsidies to help those who just need a few hundred more bucks to pay the rent. Is that something that you're going to allow to happen?
We'll look at all ways to use money effectively to get more people into housing. And, you know, that's something we can look into, those shallow subsidies. Okay, but I'll stick around for individual questions, and Nelson and Gary and Michelle will be here, too, to talk about anything else you want to talk about. Yeah, no problem. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Good to see you all.